after a week of vacation, let's try to reset our minds to a class spirit here. So with, we got to last week was the concept of a yield surface. And so the idea is that in there exists something like a stress space, yeah, if you want. And so any stress you apply to a material can be decomposed in some hydrostatic component and a deviatoric component, right? And of course, problem is always like, so what? Because, you know, what do I do with something like that? Well, so what does that mean? For instance, in practice, when you do a tensile test or any test, you know, this rule applies. So let's have a repeat what we said last week about this concept for a tensile test, right? So in a tensile test, you know, we don't have to make a lot of analysis. We know that the axis along which we stress the material will be a principal axis. And so we call this, for instance, x1. And we apply a certain stress along this x1, yes? And if we pull hard enough, so if sigma 1 here is large enough, reaches the yield strength, yes, I will have yielding. Now, so we're all familiar with that. It's just what we do when we measure stress strain curve. But before that happens, yes, let's look at the stress situation we have in the material, right? Well, we can always decompose it in the hydrostatic stress or a deviatoric stress. And this basically means that I can decompose this vector here, yes, in stress space, yeah, sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3 being principal stress directions, yes. I can decompose this in three components which equal size along x1, x2, x3, and that's just the mean value of these three. The mean value, if I only have one stress, is that stress divided by three, right? So I do one third of x, sigma x in one direction, one third of that same length in the x direction in this case, and in the y direction, right? So the sum of these three vectors, equal vectors, is the hydrostatic component of the stress that I apply. Yes, so you may not think of it as, you know, when you do a stress strain curve that there is a hydrostatic component, but actually you can always decompose the stress you apply into this hydrostatic component plus a deviatoric component. And in this case, the deviatoric component is what's left, yes, for you to get the to get to this vector. So that's the vector going from A here to this. Okay, and so this vector here, the components of this vector, yes, is are the deviatoric stresses. So and very easy to determine. Here I've gone one third in the direction I have to go, so I have to do an extra two third here. Yes. And for the other two, I just have the negative values, minus one third sigma x and minus one third sigma y, right? And so that gets me back to where I was. Now, doing things this way is interesting because we, you know, we'll go now to the, you know, what we arrive to discuss the von Mises criterion for yielding is that this hydrostatic stress and this deviatoric stress, yes, they're perpendicular to each other. They're perpendicular to each other, always. Nothing peculiar to, so you can do the more general derivation, like the one that you have in your slide, you always get this nice rule, right? So, and now we go to where we had come to, which was here last time, we had seen that on the basis of a work idea, yes, a distortion work idea, that you could come to this von Mises criterion. And so the theory is in the slides. What we want to arrive to is this: it ended up being this really nice symmetrical equation, yes? And so if you look at it in from a geometrical point of view, you find this nice tube that we call the von Mises surface, yield surface. Now, before we go on, there are two parameters that you sometimes come across, yes? And I've already talked about one of them. That's the equivalent or effective stress. So the term here on the left, right, that term here, we call the effective stress, and that is square of the effective stress. So the equivalent or effective stress is the square root of this. Okay, and this, you don't have the slide because I just made it. This should be gone. So the yield criterion, if you wanted to express it in the very shortest possible way, is by saying, well, the equivalent stress reaches the yield stress. Yeah. Okay. And on the basis of this equivalent stress definition, you can also define an equivalent strain. Yes. And the derivation for the equation for the equivalent strain or effective strain is by defining it, by saying the incremental work per unit volume, you can define it in terms of the equivalent stress and the equivalent strain in this formula here, in terms of increments of equivalent strain. And so that's this familiar equation for the work per unit volume of deformation. And so if you we're not going to go into this because it's another textbook and it's not a big focus of the course at this stage, but after some manipulation you'll find this simple equation, right? And it is useful to have this equation and will to know that you have something like an equivalent strain. We'll come to it in a moment when we talk about forming and the properties, material properties that you get from forming tests. It's nice to have an equivalent strain. Okay. So let's come back now to this particular equation here. This particular equation here. So, in geometrical form. Is basically the equation of a cylinder surface diagonally oriented in the stress space where the axes are along the principal directions. And now let's make the connection now with what we just said about hydrostatic stresses and deviatoric stresses. So any stress, yes, say for instance this point here, yes, but you can do the equivalent construction, yes, any stress, yes, so a stress situation would be from the origin to point B, yes, that defines three principal stresses, so that's the stress state of your material, yes. You can always decompose it in a vector going from the origin to A plus from A to B. Yes? And these two vectors are perpendicular to each other. And the first one from, and so I've decomposed this figure here, what happens here, into two bits. The first bit here is to show you what is the hydrostatic part, yes? So the hydrostatic part, we take the mean value of the stress, yes, for this stress state. And so if you do that, that is, so the mean stress is sigma A, yes? So you have sigma A in the x direction, sigma A in the y direction, and sigma A in the z direction. So the length of this vector here is square root 3 of sigma A. Okay? So that gives you the hydrostatic component, and then the vector A to B here, yes, is the square root of deviatoric component of the stress along the x direction, y direction, and z direction, right? And of course, the length of the vector from 0 to B is basically the length of the stress vector, right? It's square root of sigma x squares. This should be squares, by the way. Plus sigma y plus sigma z. Please make these squares. Okay? I made an error here. Okay, so... So we have a deviatoric stress and a hydrostatic stress. And this plane here, going through this point here, is the deviator plane. Okay? Right, so now, if one of the things that is of interest, in particular for many steel products, in particular flat steel products, is the case where we're interested in the yielding of the material in situation where we have plane stress. Yeah? In a situation where we don't have a stress in one of the principal directions. So sigma 3 is 0. So then we're basically looking at the intersection of this cylinder with the xy plane, yes? And when you look at this intersection, you find this curve here, which looks like an ellipse, yes, which has this equation, yeah? And you can derive it yourself. It's very simple. You just put here sigma z equals 0. It's not difficult to find this equation here. It's basically the same as the von Mises equation. Okay, and so what this basically tells you, if you have a sheet material and you pull in two directions, yeah, in two major principal directions. When you have a stress state that is on this point, the material should yield. Yes, you should see a yielding. And so you can do this experiment. There is a machine in the big hall. Yes, from the MML group, which actually does this. You know, it pulls the material in two perpendicular directions, so you know that you have a direction sigma x where you have a stress, and then you apply another stress in the other direction, yes, and you look at, you know, when does the material start to yield, yes? Yes, and so for instance, this point here would be only pulling in one direction. It's like doing a tensile test, right? And if I go along the diagonal here, yes, this point here, I'm applying the same stress in both directions, right? And I note at what stress the material starts to yield, and that gives me that particular point, yes? That particular point. Yeah? And if I do different stress ratios, I increase the stress at different stress ratios, I can basically describe a segment of this yield curve. Yes? And you can do this for steels. Mm? And here I have different steels. This is a high-strength low-alloy steel, a drawing steel, a very formable IF steel. So the softest material has the lowest yield strength, so the smallest ellipse, yes? And as I increase the strength of the material, the ellipse becomes larger. Mm? I need more stresses, larger stresses, to initiate yielding. Mm? So that's one thing. The other thing is that this yield surface, according to von Mises, yes, seems to work pretty well. Mm? Okay. Having said this, it doesn't always have to work. Right? There's no reason why it has to work. There are many things that can change the yield surface. Mm? And in particular, one of the things that that changes the yield surface is anisotropy. Mm? Anisotropy, in particular, the normal anisotropy and the planar anisotropy, when we're thinking about sheet material, you get another yield surface. Yes, other yield surface. And so, for instance, you know, let's go through the different simple possibilities. Your material can be orthotropic, yes? And think about it, basically most cold rolled sheets are what we call orthotropic. That means you measure different R values in the length direction and in the transverse direction to rolling, yes? And for these materials, the yield equation looks like this. So it has the basic three terms in sigma x squared, a product sigma x, sigma y, and sigma y squared equal to square of the yield strength, right? But it has factors, additional factors, which are functions of the planar anisotropy. Hmm? If we have only normal anisotropy, so that means that the R value in the direction parallel to the rolling and normal to the rolling are the same and equal to R, then you just put R0 and R90 equal to each other, and this formula becomes this one, yes? And if we don't have any anisotropy, like the R, and then the R value is 1, yes? Hmm? Then R is equal to R0 is equal to R90 is equal to 1. We come back to our original von Mises equation. Hmm? Okay. Now, in most cases, yes, materials and in particular steels, because we deform them, yes, to shape them into sheet or wires or beams, yes, there will be a measure of anisotropy. Hmm? And the reason why is because we get, when we do this deformation, we introduce texture, crystallographic texture. Yeah? And so let's look at a material here just as an example. So this is a material, it's a ferritic stainless steel. Hmm? It's a 439. It's titanium stabilized. It's got very, very boring microstructures. Okay, you can see here the microstructure, just ferrite grains, basically. Yeah, and so this material contains 17% of chrome. So it never goes through any transformations or so. So very simple material. You can already see that if you look at the grain structures in the normal direction, in the rolling direction, transverse direction, that there is a slight difference. Yes, but in structure. Excuse me. But the differences become even clearer when you are doing, you're taking stress strain curves. So here we have the black one, stress strain curve at 0, the red one at 45 degrees, and the one at 90 is the blue one. So you see different measures of the mechanical properties depending on the direction in which you did the measurement. That's you know, what engineers call anisotropy. Plus, what's done here in this particular slide, we have changed the amount of deformation. So here it's about 70% of rolling reduction, and then the material is annealed and we measure 75, 80, 85% about of rolling. And you can see that the anisotropy gradually decreases. Right? So again, so what does this illustrate is that if and we already know that yield strength, the tensile strength, is not a material constant. Yes, because of anisotropy, even if you're being given a yield strength or a tensile stress, you also need to know whether it was taken in the normal direction or in the transverse direction to rolling direction, like in this case, yes? Because there can be sizable differences. Yeah? And in particular, the material may look better, yes, if you do the measurement in the transverse direction than in the longitudinal direction, right? So it's always important, certainly when technical discussions about, and there's only single value is being reported, you should inquire about in what direction it was measured. Yeah? And you can see here the values, how the values change as a function of the angle. Okay, the function of the angle and the amount of deformation. The elongation will change. For instance, here you see the total elongation can be as low as 30% and as high as 36%. The anisotropy, is real, is a real point. And of course, we were talking about the aspects of the R value, the normal anisotropy. Remind you what the R value is the ratio, when you make a tensile test, the ratio of the width over the thickness strain, yes, you see very large differences. It can be at 90 degrees, it can be over 2, yes, and at 45, it can be less than 1. Okay? And if you calculate the mean value, it increases with increasing rolling reduction, and the delta R, the planar anisotropy, decreases with increasing rolling direction. That is the reason why, when you want to make a very formable sheet material, you will want to develop a very strong texture, yes? A very strong texture, which gives you low planar anisotropy, so little or reduced differences in the properties in the plane, yes, and a high R value. And this also shows you that the same material, say for instance the green material here, it's very important to know what R value is being given to you, because you can have an R value as high as 2 and as 1.2 in the same material. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with this, but you do have research data out there where people will claim, I have R value of 2, I have R value of Japanese, they're really good at that, have R values of 2.3. They don't tell you how it's measured. It very likely, if they had measured it at 45 degrees to that beautiful data, it would have been very low. Nothing abnormal with that, but it's very important to be aware of the fact that you do have this planar anisotropy. Okay, and so the reason why this happens is because you develop, in particular for steels, for ferritic steels, you develop what is called a gamma fiber, texture, study of crystallographic texture uses nowadays. In the past, we used to use pole figures to illustrate the development of texture. Nowadays, we use orientation distribution functions because they allow us to evaluate the presence and intensity of many texture components. You see, because this is the result here of such a measurement. There is a black line here, means that there is a high density of these orientations. And if you look at this schematic here that corresponds to this particular ODF, what we call ODF section, you see that they all the components start with 111 plane. So that means that all the grains, most of the grains, many of the grains, a large volume fraction of the grains have a 111 plane parallel to the surface of the sheet. Yep. And you know, that's very good for formability because it leads to a high R value, and not only a high R value, but if I may go back, a lower delta R value. You see that in the blue case, the delta R is reduced also. That's positive. Other direction. All right. And so you can look at these. There's a whole science of texture development in material science, and steel development has benefited from that. You see that you can look at the intensity of different components, texture components, as you do the deformation. So more and more and more deformation, you can see a texture component with a very low R value decreases in intensity. Texture components with higher R values, and these are the two ones that are very high. 554 is very close to 111 orientation, but you can see it increasing very much as you do additional deformation. So that's the reason why how you control the texture. So this was an example just for a stainless steel, a ferritic stainless steel. You also have it for a regular non-stainless ferritic steel, for instance, IF steel. So if you measure at different angles to the rolling direction, you always see this very familiar anisotropy with the highest R value at 90 degrees. And that's usually the one that the producers will be reporting. Yes? All right. So if we have these values at different angles, you can derive, as I said, a mean value of R, which is given by this equation, and a mean value of delta R. And these are the two equations. So if I have values, three measurements, one for R0, R45, and R90, I can calculate the mean RM and the delta R. Okay. So mean RM values are better than just R90, because usually that's the one that you will be given if you don't ask for anything else. Now, okay, so we just shown that the R value has an impact on the yield surface. So let's have a look at what happens. We're going to look at a simple situation where there is normal anisotropy. So the R value in the plane is the same, yes? So we just seen that the yield function looked like this, yes? So if I take this equation, yeah? And so I divide by the yield strength here, yes? Yield strength square. I can rewrite this equation like this. And very often people like to rewrite it this way because it makes it very easy to show a few things related to plasticity and anisotropy. So if R is equal to 1, we have the normal von Mises ellipse, yes? Again, uniaxial tensile stress would be along this line. Biaxial tension will be along this line. And you can also have torsion or simple shear or also deep drawing is similar, yeah? Yes, along this line. So these are the tension situation. So when R is equal to 1, we know that we have an ellipse. If R is equal to 2, the ellipse is stretched out. So it's kind of interesting. And I do want to point out some important features here. So this is what happens when R increases. So again, when you're doing a uniaxial tensile stress, yes, you basically start from zero. And you increase the stress, yeah? Elastic, till you hit the yields, yes? The yield stress, and it deforms, right? Okay. Now, you can also use a situation where you have a cross-like specimen, and you increase the sigma x and the sigma y with the same amount, in the same, when you increase delta y by a certain amount, you increase the sigma x with the same amount. Yes, then your stress state goes along this diagonal. Yes, right. So if R value is 1, it will start yielding in this condition. If R value is 2. It doesn't yield because I haven't reached the yield function yet. Yeah? So I have to increase the stresses. So there's no chemistry involved here. There's no deformation involved. Yeah? From here to here, the material is elastic. From here to here, the material is elastic. Right? So, but the fact that you have a higher R value means that basically it's gotten stronger for this particular stress state. So, and because this, you get higher R values because of the crystallographic texture, yes, you call this effect texture strengthening. You basically texture strengthen the material. It doesn't matter how much you texture strengthen the material, this point in uniaxial, in the uniaxial tensile test, there is no strengthening. It doesn't matter how textured your material is, it always yields at the same time. That's what this tells you. So yielding, yes, it's important, is a function of the stress state. this very clear illustration of that. And anisotropy influences the yield point, basically yield conditions, the stresses at which you get yielding. Now let's go into real plasticity, actually, because what up to now, when we were talking about the yield situation, we never really talked about plasticity. We just said, well, if we go up to this point, the material will be elastically deformed, yes? And it's only when we reach a certain amount of distortion energy, yes, that is equal to the same distortion energy it takes for a uniform tensile test to start yielding, then we have yielding, yes? But it doesn't really say, so what happens afterwards? There are three basic cases that people describe in plasticity. Is that connect our yield surface with the stress strain curve. So let's look at the familiar stress strain curve, and then connect it with this yield surface. So let's say we apply a stress along the y-axis for a change, because it's more convenient with the stress strain curve. So I increase the stress, the strain increases, yes, but it's all elastic, right? And say we have what is called a perfectly plastic material, yes? Perfectly plastic material doesn't strain harden, right? As soon as you have reached the yield stress, the stresses remain the same if you want to continue deforming the material. So you have a flat plastic part of the curve, yes? Okay, now I reverse the stress, I reverse the stress, so I've gone from here to here. The yielding, yes, is at this point. I can continue straining the material. This will remain the yield surface at all times. Yes, it doesn't matter how much I deform the material, because this is what the stress strain looks like. Okay, I go back, go into negative territory, yes? Material yields when I reach this point, yes? Exactly the minus value of this yield strength, yes? It doesn't harden, and the yield surface basically remains the yield surface, yes? That's the case, very simple case, of no hardening, okay? Of course, we know that that's not the case. I mean, when we have a stress strain curve of steel, it'll look like this. I'll have an elastic part. The material will yield, and then I will, if I strain it a little bit, I'll end up having some kind of flow stress. Yes. So it basically means that the yield surface expands. And in this particular case, it expands uniformly, okay? When it expands uniformly, like I've drawn here, we say it's isotropic hardening. Okay, and now I want to continue the story here, So my yield surface, after I've deformed it a bit, beyond the yield stress, beyond the elastic limit, yes? This is the new yield surface, yes? Okay, now let's go back, yes? And I do the reverse. I go and I reduce the applied stress, yes? And I go into negative territory. And so this now tells me that the material will yield, not at this point, not when I reach this point, no, the material now yields when I reach this point, okay? Okay. So every time I go back and forth, Yes? Every time I go back and forth, I can go back and forth like this. Like this. The stress strain curve I'm going to describe will, become larger. Yes? But it turns out, and in particular, it's the case with steel very often, is that that doesn't happen in practice. In practice, we very often don't have this isotropic hardening. Yes? And I'm sure that you have heard in your undergraduate classes about the so-called Bauschinger effect. Bauschinger effect consists of the following. When you take a sample, steel sample, yes, you pull it, yes, you measure a certain amount of yield stress. Yes? So you think, if I reverse the direction, instead of having tension, I go into compression, I should get yielding at a higher value than the yield strength here. Yes? Right? Because my yield surface has expanded. It turns out that that's not the case. Your yield strength is lower. Yes? This phenomenon is called the Bauschinger effect. Yes? And so how do you represent this in the and how do you still use the concept of the a yield surface, right? If you can't trust the direction of the stress that you're applying, even in a simple case like a tensile test, well, we say that in that case we have kinematic hardening, yes? And instead of expanding, of having an isotropic expansion of the yield surface, we get a translation of the yield surface in stress space. So when we start, so we apply a stress, yes? We pass the yield stress, so the material now hardens, yes? And I reach a certain flow stress and I stop my test, yes? So now, if I were to repeat the test, decrease the stress and then start again, this is where it would yield, right? So I know this is now my von Mises surface, yes? Or yield condition. If I move my yield function in the direction of the applied stress, like I've done here, yes, I go back, yes, and now it should normally yield at this point, yes, because I've shifted the yield surface upward, it will yield here at a lower value, yes? And this allows me, yes, to describe plastic behavior, yes, if Bauschinger effect occurs, yes? And again, in the case of steels, yes, we Bauschinger is a rather common occurrence. For instance, in particular, in certain industries, it's really important. In other industries, it's not important. Obviously, it's related to the fact that in service, is the steel subject to compression or tension? Car body is rarely subjected to compression, because if you buckle a thin material, it will elastically collapse before you get into compression. Yes, you'll have buckling. What's called buckling. Yes, in the case of, however, of thick-walled pipes. Yes, it's the Bauschinger effect is important. Yes. Or forgings, for instance, same thing. Okay. So when we change, when we stress the material beyond the yield points, we go into the realm of plasticity, right? And in the realm of plasticity, there's no such thing as Hooke's laws. Doesn't exist, right? There's no linear relationship between stresses and strains. Yes, but there are some fundamental relationships. But before we start, we need to say something about the yield surface. Yes, the yield surface is something in stress space, okay, but it's got some very essential bits of information about the plastic strain increment. Yes. So when I change the stress a little bit, yes, there will be strain. There will be deformation, right? Because I'm in plastic region. There will be deformations. The yield surface tells me in what direction the deformation will go, right? It'll be clear in a moment. But let's just say you accept this from me, right? So what does it basically mean? What is this this essential bit of information about the plastic strain increment? It tells me this that the strain increment is always perpendicular to the yield surface. Yeah? So this is the yield surface. Somehow, so I draw the tangent to the yield surface, and somehow the vector that's perpendicular to this tangent, yes, tells me something about the direction of the strain increment. Yeah? And this is a very important rule. It's called the normality rule. Yes, yeah? And basically says that the plastic strain vector is normal to the yield surface. Okay. So let's just have a look at this. Let's just assume we accept this. Yes. And we look at what this means in practice. Okay. So this is the simple form of the von Mises equation for R equal 1, no anisotropy, and I can rewrite it as F is equal to 0. That's like a function, right? Like a simple mathematical function F of these two variables is 0. Okay. And let me calculate what is the vector normal to the yield surface. Okay. So if I want to have know what the vector is, I just do the derivative. Yeah? Derivative to with respect to sigma x and derivative with respect to sigma y. And so derivative is here. Is 2 times sigma x minus sigma y, and then the derivative with respect to sigma y is minus sigma x plus 2 times sigma y. So this is a derivative. It does, you know, any place. If this is f, the derivative to f has two components. Okay, so anywhere here. Yes, these are the coordinates of the derivative to that equation, to f. Okay, and now let's just have a look at, okay, we were just talking about this point, right? So in this point, sigma x is equal to sigma y, right? So I put this knowledge, this characteristic of this particular stress state in this. Sigma x is sigma y, so this is sigma x, comma, sigma y. Okay? So what does it tell me? Is that the normal here is, of course, pointing in the same direction as the stress, yeah? This is a stress factor, yes? Okay, and you'll say to me, well, you know, this is very simple math, right? It's just, we knew that, I didn't have to do the calculation, right? Because this is, you know, it's curved that way, okay? So, but it basically means here the normality rule tells me that if I strain these directions, yes, I will get a component of strain in the x and the y directions, which are equal, right? Okay. So nothing really special. Now, okay, well, what happens if we do a uniaxial tensile test, right? It should be even simpler, right? There should be one component, just a stress, a strain, yes, in the direction of the stress, right? That's what you would think. But of course not, there isn't, yes? Yes? So now, okay, so first let's look at the simple case which we just had, where we calculate the derivative on the von Mises equation for r equal 1. Hmm? And now we are here. Yeah? But if I look carefully, this is the tangent to this line, yes? And the normal is not parallel to the stress. It's not, right? You can see. So whereas I only have one component, an x component, if for the stress vector, I have two components. I have an x component and a y component for the strain, for the strain. Yeah, I'll have an x component and a y component. Yeah? And so if r is equal to 1, I calculate, I just use this, right? So in this case, sigma y is 0, I have 2 sigma x minus sigma x. So this would be this. Basically tells me that the strain in the x component will be twice the strain in the y component, and the strain in the y direction will be negative, not positive. When you come to think about it, of course, when you pull a material, yes, in the length direction, yes, say it's a flat material, yeah, say it's not thinning in the width direction, right? Just so when I pull, it's got to contract, right? So there are indeed two principal strains, yes, for that particular stress state in your tensile specimen. Okay. So now we can redo this type of calculation using this equation, where r is not equal to 1, but it's equal to 2. Yes, and in this case, turns out that for r equals to 2, we get d sigma x is 2 times sigma x, and the other one is minus 4/3 sigma x. So when r increases, yes, I have a figure, yes, when r increases, the width over length ratio, the strain changes. This is shown here, what this normality rule means for us. So in the case of biaxial stress, yeah, so we go along the diagonal here, it means that I get two strains in the positive sigma x and sigma y direction. Yes. In the uniaxial stress direction, that is what happens when you do a tensile test, I have a strain. When I pull, I strain not only in the x direction, but also in the width direction. The material becomes thinner, yes? So this is this. Yeah, the material becomes less wide, excuse me, wide. Yeah? And this is influenced by the R value. So this is shown here in this schematic here. So this is the yield surface. This straight line is the tangent to the yield surface. And this is the case for R equal 1. The ratio of dy over dx, yes, so this is along the tensile direction. This is perpendicular to it. Yeah? Is 1/2, minus 1/2. If I increase R from 1 to 2, yes, same equations. Now, the width over, oops, this is an error here, yes. If you have this, so this should be y divided by epsilon x. I just noticed this. Yeah? Please correct it because it's an error here and here. So this should be d epsilon x. But the drawing is fine. And here it's OK, too. OK, so it means that you get more width strain. Yeah, width strain increases from, because this ratio goes from 0.5 to 0.66. Right? So the R value also influences the strains that we get. So if R increases, you get increase in the width strain. And as a consequence, a reduction in the thickness strain. And that's really nice because it means that you strain a material in one direction, yes, it will tend to get narrower, thinner, and less wide. Yes, the larger the R value is, this shows you that you get less thinning because the width strain becomes larger. Oh, okay. And before we go back here, there's another interesting situation, and it's this one here. Yeah, because you may wonder, yes, are there situations where we only have strain in one direction? Yes. Yes. And there is. If you look carefully at your yield function, yeah, there is this point here, yes, where the tangent is vertical, yes, and where the normal factor, which the rule of normality says this vector is in the increment in strain is parallel to this this normal, yes. You can see that here I only have a strain in the x direction, yes. Yes, and it's not a tensile test, right? It's not a tensile test because the stress state is here. This is the stress state. Right? This is so. Sigma x, sigma y, and this sigma. Yeah. So it's a test you would do, for instance, you could do here. So what happens in this case? Yeah, this case is called, yes, this case is called plane strain case. Why is it? Because d epsilon y, the strain in the y direction is 0. Yes? So the material gets deformed in such a way that, yes, there is no width strain. But you know that when you do plastic deformation, the volume has to remain constant. So if you make it longer this way, it has to thin. Yes? So plane strain is a very dangerous deformation situation, because any strain in the major direction is automatically compensated by thinning, right? And when materials thins, you get closer to necking and fracture, right? So this is a so plane strain conditions are therefore always very bothersome, yes, and in many situations, yeah? But in forming also to plane strain situation. Now, how does this work? Well, obviously, remember when you're the reason why in when you do uniform uniaxial tensile test, the material on the sides is free to move. Is free to move. Yes. When you're doing a plane strain condition, you basically prevent this from happening by applying a positive stress on the sides. Yes? Okay. And that's the reason why you need to have a positive sigma y. Yes, to prevent deformation in the width direction. Okay. So right. So now we've said a few things about the yield surface. I've already told you that something must happen to the yield surface as we strain the material. It can be no hardening. It can be isotropically hardened, or if I have things like the Bochinger effect, kinematic hardening, yeah? Shifting of the yield surface. And then we have this really nice rule, yes, which is the normality rule, which tells us something about the directions of increments, small increments of strain. So, and in plasticity, what people work with is not with stress and strain, but with stress and increments of strain, right? Yeah. So what do we need for plasticity? We need Hooke's laws, because we need those for the initial stages of the deformation. Then we need to know when does it stop to apply these elastic relations, Hooke's laws. We need a criterion for yielding, yeah, to determine at what plastic deformation or at what stress rate plastic deformation starts. Then we need a work hardening rule, yes? And so we need to know how, even in the isotropic state, we need to know how the yield surface expands. And we need to have a flow rule. And this is the last thing we'll be discussing, which describes the evolution of the plastic strain. And it basically, that flow rule, it's basically the equivalent, if you want, to Hooke's law in elasticity. But it doesn't relate stress to deformation. It relates stress to increments of plastic deformation, yeah? small amounts of deformation. Yeah? Okay? So we just talked about the normality rule, and I told you these incremental strains are related to the yield surface, yes, in a very simple way, yes, yeah, is that the strain components are the components of the vector normal to the yield surface. So that's very nice, right? So if I know the derivative of this curve, and very simple, well, it's not simple because I've made it very simple for this course. It is this simple. Yeah, is proportional to d epsilon x. The derivative to y direction is proportional to d epsilon y and d epsilon z. The trouble is, of course, I only know something about the fact that they're proportional. It doesn't say anything about their size, yes? And that's why we need this flow rule, relating increments, these increments to, so this increment to this stress, yeah? And, okay, so the flow rule, yes? So we'll just, again, because it's not really necessary to make things that complicated at this stage in the course, we'll just look at the uniaxial tensile test and look at the flow rule for this particular test. And you can expand it to the general situation. Actually, the equations don't look much more difficult. So this is the stress state. Sigma x is not zero, and then sigma y and sigma z are zero in our uniaxial tensile test. We can easily calculate the mean stress, yes, and the deviatoric stress. And the mean stress is 1/3 of the sum of these three guys, yes. And so because only one is non-zero, it's sigma x divided by 3. And I can also calculate deviatoric stresses. So for instance, for sigma x dash, it's sigma x minus the mean value, right? So that it's 2/3 of sigma x, and then sigma y is minus 1/3 of sigma x, and sigma z is 1/3 of sigma x. And then I can also look at, so these are all stress-related equations, right? Let's now look at the incompressibility. That we have in the case of plastic deformation. So again, if I stress in one direction, plastically, yes, the stresses in the stress in one direction, the strains in the three directions, yes, must be such that when you sum them, their sum is zero, right? So the sum of dx dy d epsilon x, d epsilon y, and d epsilon z is zero, yes? And obviously, I'm pulling in one direction, so d epsilon, the reason why you find this, you go from here to here, maybe you want to add this on your slide, is because d epsilon y and d epsilon z are equal to each other, right? Then you will find this equation. Right, and so if you now combine these equations and these equations, and you make ratios, yeah? So you make the ratio of the deviatoric stress component in the y direction, deviatoric stress component in the x direction, you make this ratio, you find minus 1/2. If you make the same ratios, but now for the strain components, d epsilon y over d epsilon x, you also find 1.5, right? And so you can combine these two equations to find something that's really interesting, namely that the strain increment in the x direction divided by the deviatoric stress component in the x direction is equal to the same ratio in the y direction and same ratio in the z direction, yes? So this it basically tells me that this ratio somehow is constant, yes? It's a constant. And what we do, and we call this d lambda. It's just a name, right? Just a name, and we'll see if there is any way to determine this d lambda. Yes? Right, and basically, we're there. We're there because I now have a relation between my plastic increments and the stress, deviatoric stress. It's equal to d lambda, which is kind of, obviously, it's when you look deeply, think deeply at it, you're not much more intelligent, right? Because it's, now the question is, what's d lambda, right? Okay. So anyway, we'll see in a moment how we do this. But people like to sometimes change this equation into an equation where we don't have deviatoric stresses, and so they will change the this deviatoric stress here into in terms of the sigma x's, sigma y, and sigma z, the definition, yes? So this allows you now to rewrite this equation, these equations for d epsilon x, d epsilon y, and d epsilon z in this manner, right? Very symmetrical. And eventually, for uniaxial tensile test, where sigma y and sigma z are zero, it gets simplified to this. And so for our tensile test, this is what I get. I get d sigma epsilon x over sigma x is 2/3 d lambda. And I have a nice relationship between my increment of strain and stress equal to this. So question is, of course, what does it all mean? Yes, well, in the case of a tensile, uniform tensile test, it's relatively simple to illustrate how you would get to d lambda. So you know that in a uniform in a tensile test, I can replace strains and stresses by their equivalent values. Yeah, so I basically get this. Yes, and so a stress strain curve. So you have a stress strain curve here. Yes, so which is your stress strain curve, or you can write it down as an equivalent stress equivalent strain curve. Yes, it's the same. In the case of a uniaxial test, so below the yield strength, things go along the elastic modulus, and beyond that, our strain consists of an elastic part and a plastic part. So the total strain is this. Okay, now I can take out and use my raw data here to take out only the plastic strain. Yes, so the function now starts at the yield stress and increases, right? Well, we basically look at a specific flow stress, equivalent stress here, yes, and we look at a small amount of strain, d epsilon, yes. Well, the curve now tells me, yeah, what d lambda is. If this is d epsilon e, this angle here being theta, so 1 over the tangent of theta is the ratio of this divided by this. So it's d epsilon e divided by sigma e is nothing else than 2/3 of this. Yeah, so that gives me d lambda. Yeah? I can only do this, of course, if I know this. I need to know this behavior, yes? Okay? And so this brings me to a point, yes, that you cannot get this d lambda unless you have some way to you have some theory of strength in your steel, yes? And unless you have a theory for the hardening of the steel, yes? If you don't have that, you don't get, you know, you won't get this d lambda, yes? And so that's what we'll be talking about in the coming lectures, about this theory of strength and of hardening of steels, which allows you to apply plasticity in practice. Okay, I've gone a little bit over time because I wanted to end up here. Thank you for your patience. And.